questa mattina a sentire l'intervento di Stephen Hawking via Zamponi all'università. Veramente due parole per l'introduzione. È un antropologo, Stephen Hawking, dell'università di Stellenbosch. Stellenbosch è una cittadina vicino a Cape Town, nella zona, diciamo, boera, la chiamo la Baviera del Sudafrica. Molto bella, famosa per i vini, quindi questa zona estremamente bella. E lui ha lavorato dapprima in Zimbabwe, poi a partire dagli anni 90 è ritornato a lavorare con Antropologo in Sudafrica, perché insomma sono gli anni del grande cambiamento in Sudafrica, quando Mandela esce di prigione e dopo poco diventa presidente, la fine del regime dell'apartheid, quindi c'era tutta una... Sudafrica è un terreno molto interessante e si è occupato di movimenti sociali sostanzialmente. Oggi ci parlerà dei movimenti sociali legati al contro la privatizzazione dell'acqua a Cape Town. Anche i giornali italiani, diciamo, già oggi ne hanno parlato, no? Che da Città del Capo sono 2-3 anni che c'è una siccità forte, e quindi c'è una forte carenza d'acqua, e c'è stato anche un tentativo da parte della municipalità di Cape Town, che non è governata dall'ANC ma da un partito bianco d'opposizione, in quel caso lì, di privatizzare l'acqua. E allora lì sono nati tutta una serie di movimenti sociali intorno al tema dell'acqua. E dico solo questo, che questi movimenti sociali però si inseriscono all'interno di una storia già piuttosto consolidata di movimenti sociali in Sudafrica. Va da sé, ovviamente, quello dell'African National Congress, un partito politico, o del Partito Comunista Sudafricano, quindi questa forte relazione anche storica che c'è con la Russia, soprattutto l'ANC, ma una forte anche tradizione marxista e via dicendo. Ma poi pensiamo anche nel post-apartheid, soprattutto il movimento sociale che poi ha avuto un'importanza planetaria, quello del Treatment Action Campaign, cioè tutto il movimento per far sì che i farmaci antiretrovirali fossero gratuiti, distribuiti gratuitamente al sistema sanitario, laddove al tempo, stiamo parlando degli anni 90, c'erano ancora i copyright delle case farmaceutiche e quindi non vi era accesso a questi medicinali, laddove il tasso di infezione dell'HIV in Sudafrica è superiore al 10%, quindi potete immaginare. E questo Treatment Action Campaign ha avuto successo, adesso i farmaci antiretrovirali sono distribuiti dal sistema sanitario pubblico, che in Sudafrica devo dire non costa, il sistema sanitario pubblico è gratuito, proprio per questa tradizione, se vogliamo, anche marxista, delle ansie, eccetera. E comunque, come ci sono delle questioni comune anche a noi, perché tutto sommato è un tema che è generale, di cui si occupa Steven, di cui molti di noi si occupano, è il fatto che, come dire, il mercato o il privato invade il bene pubblico, cioè tutto viene svenduto, come sappiamo, in questi giorni, i prati di Caprara, Bologna, cosa sta succedendo, cioè tutto quello che sono i comuni, i beni comuni, eccetera, vengono privatizzati, svenduti, insomma, un capitalismo che ormai, come dire, penetra da tutte le parti, tutto viene mercificato e dicendo. E quindi ci sono ancora dei movimenti di resistenza, come fa sì, nel caso specifico, che l'acqua continui a rimanere un bene pubblico. That's all. Okay. I sit here so in case there is some... Okay, some...
Grazie. Okay. Thank you very much for making this event possible. Some of you heard me talk for a long time this afternoon on related issues about the politics of sanitation and how these were AIDS activism and then sanitation activism. So how people try to realize rights to basic services such as healthcare and clean water and sanitation. So in a way, what I've been drawn to is the question of basic services. Or I can just talk louder about this. Is that clear? Okay. So I'm going to hopefully talk less now and leave more time for discussion. And I would be open to discussing a whole range of issues about South Africa. But I'm going to tell the story of Day Zero, and perhaps some of you picked up this term. It circulated quite widely in South Africa, you know, since 2017. The country had been in a drought for 3 years, one of the most serious drought in 100 years in South Africa. And so there was a real fear that we would one day open the taps and no water would come. That, you know, would flow. And that was Day Zero. That was our Day Zero. And what it did do is it created such fear in the public that we managed to bring down the water consumption dramatically from 1.2 billion liters per day to around 510 to 520 liters per day. And this was, as I mentioned earlier, this was a historically unprecedented drop in water consumption. Nowhere else in the world has this been achieved. So suddenly Cape Town saw itself at the cutting edge of addressing global climate change. So we sort of, you know, moved from fear to almost celebration of the fact that it was possible to produce this dramatic drop in water use. And it seemed as if this very abstract idea of the Anthropocene and global climate change landed in South Africa and became real. Even though, you know, I've read a lot about it, and we all hear about it in public discourse and in the media, it still remained for me and for many others quite abstract. You know, I thought about how do you study something like global climate change? But, you know, because it seems nowhere and everywhere. And what was really interesting was to see how this extreme drought brought home the realities of this very abstract idea of climate change. And the everyday practices of people became very interesting to observe. So I just went to your toilets, you know, before I started my talk. And I had to think twice before I flushed the toilet, because back home we don't flush the toilets, and we feel very virtuous about not flushing the toilet. You collect the grey water from your shower and you pour it into the toilet. And this I've been doing, it's almost second nature, I've been doing it for a very long time. And I'm not the only one, there are, you know, many, many other people in Cape Town doing it. And then, you know, that's just one angle of it. What happened was, in the midst of this Day Zero crisis, particularly the middle classes, or I refer to as the chattering classes, would sit around dinner tables and restaurants and cafes and talk about their latest method of saving water. And there were, as I mentioned early on today, there was this idea of responsibilized citizenship, civic virtue through saving water. And it was played up quite a lot by the city of Cape Town. So it, on the one level, inculcated a sense of deep fear that the infrastructure system would collapse. And not only do you not have water, but also the sanitation system cannot function without water. So, you know, there was an apocalyptic vision of what would happen in Day Zero, but at the same time it triggered these ways of seeing water that we never had before. So new ways of seeing water emerged in this context. And there were all sorts of technologically mediated forms of messaging. So if you look on the left there, suddenly, you know, you could go onto a website and you could observe the levels of dams in Cape Town. They dropped dramatically, and people were learning about the technical nature of a whole range of aspects about water. And that, again, some of you have heard early on, I spoke about this idea of infrastructure. Susan Lee Starr is a famous ethnographer on infrastructure, and she makes this interesting observation that infrastructure is used usually invisible. It's hidden. It's buried away in underground pipes. We don't know where the water comes from. We don't really know where the sewage water goes to. We just know that the state takes care of it. If we're middle class and we've got this infrastructure at our disposal. If we're poor, we don't have it, and we're very aware of the absence of infrastructure. So it's a highly unequal relationship to infrastructure. People, and I spoke today a lot about the politics and management of human waste and the problems that it creates in informal settlements or favelas, shanty towns where people don't have modern toilets, they don't have sewage, and they don't have the basics that the middle classes take for granted. So, as I pointed out, you know, when we flush the toilet, it's one movement, as I did an hour, I felt guilty, but I didn't. One movement, and the water and the waste is out of sight, out of mind. And that's quite a powerful experience. You don't have to think about it beyond the flush, but in the talk I gave today, it becomes clear that for activists and for people living these everyday realities without infrastructure, it can lead to a sense of an experience of violation, of indignity, of living with waste in your immediate everyday life and being unable to distance yourself from your own living waste. And I'm not going to talk about that today, but if you're interested, I could mention sanitation and activism and the tactics that were used to make these everyday lived realities more visible, particularly to political and economic elites who can't understand it, they can't see it because it's happening in the peripheries of the city. And they can't imagine living under those conditions because they have the infrastructure at their disposal. So suddenly when it came to water, we began to learn, and we, you know, it would be interesting to understand who the we is that got caught up in these new pedagogies of water. So we learned about how much water we use to brush our teeth, how much water we use to flush a toilet, how much water we use in the dishwashing machine. I mean, this was absolutely new for me and for many others, because water had seemed as if it was an unlimited resource. We've been exposed to ideas about water scarcity and climate change and all the rest, but the actual lived realities indicated that the water would flow indefinitely. Suddenly, this messaging came. There was a possibility of the water flow being turned off. So the city, you know, began this big pedagogical exercise of teaching mostly the middle classes, because they were the culprits, they were the over-consumers, they were the ones who were the problem, which is quite interesting, again, for a city like Cape Town, where often the poor are blamed for everything, for crime, for this, for that, and suddenly the problem, the target population, were these people in the suburbs who clean their cars with water, they use too much water for their nice green lawns, they use water for their appliances, their washing machines, etc. They were the problem. They were the ones who had to come down in their water consumption, and the level that was agreed upon was that each person had to come down to 50 liters per person per day. I wonder how much water you use. Are you aware? I'm sure nobody's really aware, but we actually learned what it, you know, different chores, showering had to be for, you know, 30, well, under a minute, you know, and most people shower for much longer. Again, initially, I'm enjoying my showers, but I feel guilty, you know, so it's on, and then to put the soap on, I switch off the shower. Then I realize that I'm in Italy, but then again, Italy probably, you know, quite recently, Rome had a major water crisis. So this is a global story. But it's about how these microprocesses can start and reshape the consumption of resources at a population level. So I'm still quite acutely aware of every usage of water, but that could fade if we have more rains as we're having now,
and after 2 or 3 years, the water level was rising. But nonetheless, there was a moment in which these behavioral scientists, such as Rigaya and Kotia, seemed to be celebrating the fact that you could, through messaging, change consumption at a level of a large population. So these are the two kinds of messaging. In this case, this guy David Perrott, who's a behavioral scientist, claims that there's a science of behavioral change. I'm not so sure that science works in the way it simply. So for example, the first message is seen to be problematic because it implies that some people are not compliant, and therefore this produces frustration and people may not be as committed to it. And the second one comes from the leader of the Democratic Alliance, Musili Maimani, and he congratulates the population, you know, for dropping consumption. So this, you know, these multiple forms of messaging were circulating and were producing a form of water literacy. People were learning about water in ways that they never had been exposed to before. So again, you see this image, you know, so there was a large production of forms of pedagogy around water. Now, what the water crisis brought home were these structural inequalities in a city like Cape Town. It's a post-apartheid city, but the continuities of apartheid are very visible at the level of socio-spatial segregation, where the rich live, where the poor live, etc. But in the midst of this crisis, there was a representation in the media of Capetonians all coming together in the face of this adversity, in the face of this crisis, coming together as one nation. And both South African and international journalists really took up this narrative. So I would like to give you a sense of how this narrative played out. So I live in a suburb called Newlands. It's a middle-class suburb, and it happens to have a series of springs in the neighborhood. And these springs have been used for very long time, hundreds of years, and they've kept running. And there was one particular spring called the Kildare Spring, which was very close to where I live. And we used to collect water there every now and then. But during the height of the Day Zero crisis, what happened was people started converging on the spring in very large numbers from all over the city. Okay, so it's a historically white middle-class neighborhood, still very white and very middle-class. And people from colored and Muslim working-class neighborhoods in Cape Flats and Cape Town started coming in large numbers. The roads were jam-packed with cars, and there was traffic congestion, and I started going to the spring more often, you know, as the crisis became more serious around January 2018. And I found it to be really interesting. Let me get to some images of it, okay. First of all, that particular spring had one water point. And a man who I got to know very well, Riaz Rawat, a Sufi man, found the space of serenity, and he thought the water was pure. So there was something about his spiritual connection to this place that got him really involved in this particular spring. He had gone there before the crisis. His family had lived in that area before they were forcibly removed in the 1960s because of apartheid laws, the Gumperius Act, but he still maintained a connection to this place. And he realized, once people started coming in larger and larger numbers, that this one water point wasn't enough. So he started tinkering with this pipe. This is Riaz. And he, you know, first of all, he realized the place was quite muddy and he put down concrete so people wouldn't get wet when they collected water. But there was still only one water pond. Then he started messing around with this pipe, you know, working out how he could have more water points. In a short while, he created 26 water points in this one pipe. So 26 holes, 26 people could collect water simultaneously, and the numbers started coming in from 100 to thousands of people per day. It became a key site for the representation of Day Zero. So every international journalist or television station filmed or photographed or wrote about the Gildero experiment. You can scan them from CNN, Al Jazeera, Lieutenant, you saw some coverage of it. It became the big story of Day Zero. There was another screen, but that was on the property of one of the largest corporations in South Africa, a brewery. South African breweries that make beer, they had a spring, but it was a highly regulated space. This space was quite anarchic in a way, because Riaz did it all himself in quite an improvised way. So it was, you can see this pipe structure, so, you know, it's held together with string, and it really looks quite rough and ready, but yet it was the object around which extraordinary social life emerged. I mean, I didn't only go for water. I went for the social life of the spring. We'd have conversations across the race and class line. You'd have a sense of a public space in a city that's highly regulated and regimented. You know, without romanticizing the space too much, it became a very interesting space. In the media representations of it, as I mentioned earlier, it was seen to be a place where this new public emerged, a diverse public where people came together in a time of crisis, etc. And the problem was that it was in this middle class neighborhood, and the residents felt that this was creating disorder in the neighborhood. And so I went with Riaz to meetings, and we, you know, residents wanted to shut it down. And of course, if it was shut down, it's the way power works. The city of Cape Town eventually, you know, covered this entire spring, and that's what it looks like now. That's me on the right there, you know, just.